Welcome to the lectures on surveying work, CE 255. In today's lecture, we will learn about the introduction to the survey. So first of all, what is surveying? The survey is nothing but it is the first step before starting any project. This is if you are going for any civil engineering project, it may be a geotechnical, it may be transportation engineering related, or it may be the structural engineering related. If you have means, the basic means to say is that if you are studying any civil engineering related project, the first thing what you have to do, that is the survey. It can be any type of survey, but the survey is the first thing which involves in each and every project. So therefore, we can define the survey as it is a science, and or to say it is the art of determining the relative position of the various points above, on or below the earth surface. That means we can establish various control points. If these points are on the paper, that means if you are having any drawing on the paper or on the sheets, then we can transfer all these points from the sheets to the ground, as well as we can bring the control points or the drawing from the ground to the sheets. So what are the objectives of this subject, or to say of this survey? That is to fix up the relative position, as we have understood right now. That if you are having any drawing like plane table survey or anything you are having, and if you have any drawings, then we can transfer all these points on the ground, or we can fix up the relative positions of the control points or the reference point, as we used to do in triangulation. Similarly, to prepare a layout and mark the position of proposed structure on the ground, like in plane table survey by radiation method, intersection method, as well as to calculate the areas. Here we can to measure the area of irregular bodies. We can use the digital planning meter. That is to calculate the areas, volumes, and other things for the regular body. If it is a regular body like a square or polygonal shape or the rectangular shape, then we know the formulas and each and everything. So by using the conventional methods, we can find out the area. But if you are having the irregular body, then what to do? How to find out? Then, if suppose this is the body of something this kind. Suppose this is the kind of body. How to find out the area of this kind of body? This is the irregular body. In this case, by using the digital planning meter, we can find out the area of any irregular body. So these are some of the objectives which are not possible in a simple way or in a conventional way that we can do using these equipments. So these are some of the objectives of survey. About some of the basic branches of survey. Basic branches of survey on the basis of the curvature of earth. Whether we are considering the curvature of earth, means whether the curvature of earth is considered or the flat earth surface considered is assumed to be flat. On the basis of these things, we generally classify the survey into two parts. One is survey, another one is geodetic survey. So what we are saying, on the basis of the assumptions, whether there are distance or whether the ground which is considered for the survey, whether it's the ground is considered to be flat, whether that means to say whether it is assumed to be flat for the survey, or the curvature of earth is considered in that survey, on the basis of this, the survey is classified in two categories. That these are known as the basic branches of surveying or the division of surveying. These are the plane surveying or the geodetic survey. In the plane surveying, if you are doing the survey on a small area, doing the survey on estimated area, such as the distance is less than the radius of Earth, such that distance is less than the radius of Earth, then we consider the Earth's surface to be flat. That means we do not consider in that case the curvature of Earth. We are considering the Earth's surface to be flat. That means whatever the horizontal angle and the horizontal distance are measured, they are considered within the horizontal plane. Means horizontal angle and horizontal distance measure is assumed to be measured in a horizontal plane. Because as the distance is less than the radius of Earth, then the difference will be the very minute or the very marginal. That is not the substantial difference, and it is the difference is this that much less that we can consider, we can ignorable. It is not significant to consider that much the margin. So that's why if the radius or the distance is less than the radius of Earth, and that can, in that situation we consider the, we do not consider the curvature of Earth, or the distance measured is assumed, or the surface is assumed to be flat. That means the distance measured, it is assumed that distance is measured in a horizontal plane. Why? In case of geodetic survey, when we are doing the survey on a large area, the curvature of Earth is considered. Curvature of Earth is considered. Obviously, if we are considering the curvature of Earth, the accuracy will be more, or to say the preciseness will be more. Accuracy is high. We generally consider it when we are surveying on the large areas. So, the curvature of Earth is considered. When we are surveying on a large area, it is compulsory, it is mandatory to consider the curvature of Earth. In that case, the survey what we have done, that is known as the geodetic survey, and obviously the accuracy will be high as we are considering the actual situation or the actual scenario. See, this is the basic branches or the division of surveying. One is plane survey and another one is geodetic survey on the basis of curvature of Earth. Next we have the principles of surveying. As we are learning this in this subject, surveying, that is surveying one, we have started from the introduction, we have seen the basic branches of surveying. Now we will see the principle of surveying. The first basic principle is whole to part. Okay, now we are learning about the principle of surveying. The first principle is the whole to part. What does this mean? Whole to part means the whole to part. The principle, the first basic principle of surveying says at work from whole to part. That means whenever surveying is starting the surveying, he must work from the whole to part. That means he must work from outside to inside. He must work from outside to inside. That means from the large framework to the internal framework. From the large framework to the internal framework, that's what we want to say here. Initial, or we can say the small, or the internal, any word we can use here. You are trying to say that the hole to path, that means you start working from hole to path, that means from outside, start from outside and close your work at the internal part side, or that means to say from inside wind. You start working from the large framework to the internal, to the small framework, that is internal framework, so that the errors will not get accumulated. How to say, if you follow hole to path, the errors will get localized, they will be minimized. The errors will not accumulate, but you will start working from part to wall, that means if you start working from the smaller one to the outer one, or from inner one to the outer one, or to say from a small framework to the large framework, in next situation the error will get accumulated, just because of you are starting from the center point and you are going outside. If you have done the mistake at the stage number one, that is error will get definitely accumulated at stage number two. If there is some other error at stage number two, then it will further get accumulated, and at last you will end up with some other boundaries other than the actual one. But if you are starting working from the outside to the inside one, that is from hole to part, what will happen? With a high accuracy, we can fix up the boundaries. Like in this case, we can see these boundaries are fixed up. And then we will go inside, then the accuracy will be higher. And if there is some, due to some human errors or due to some other errors, if there is even some error, that error can be minimized, or that error can be divided within the bounded itself, so that the error will be localized or the error will be minimized. So we always do the work by following this principle, that is hole to part. The part to wall is not at all allowed in the survey. That we can understand in this example. We can take this triangle as example number one. Here the PQR we can consider as a relative point or the reference point. These points are fixed up, and this distance, that is PQ, QR and the PR, are fixed up with the high accuracy, so that the outer boundary we have the fixed up. Now we are going from hole to part, that we are moving here from outside to the inside. Here we can see after fixing with the less accuracy, we have fixed up the point, the reference point or the subcontrol point, that is S, T and B. We have fixed up the point S on the line PQ, B on the QR, as well as T on the PR point with the less accuracy. Because with high accuracy, we have already fixed up the line PQ. So we know the position of line PQ. So obviously the position of S will be automatically correct here, because S is lying on the line PQ. Similarly, P is lying on the line QR. So that position of B will automatically correct. There is no chance of error. Similarly, after fixing STV with the less accuracy, we will fix up the ST, SV and VT. So we will get, so again we have moved one point further. After that, we have fixed again the subcontrol point, that is X, Y, Z. X we can see it is lying on ST, so as ST is already fixed up, so there is chances of error are still minimized. Similarly, what we are doing here, we are working from all to part and we are localizing the error, that means we are minimizing the errors, and therefore the point we adopt in surveying, the method, that is all to part, this is known as the principle of surveying, and we never allow the part to hold. That you can see here the part to hole. Is never allowed, because the error will get accumulated in this case. We can understand the same method by taking one more example. We have fixed up the alignment from A to B. This is A and this is B. And right now we are interested to measure the distance from point A to point B. So we will fix up some ranging. By helping the ranging, we will fix up some of the point. Let's say that this is X, this is Y, and this is Z. So in this case also we will apply the same formula, that is hole to path. This is the hole. So first of all, we will fix up the point A and point B. So large framework, router framework is fixed. Now from hole to the, we will work towards the part. That from outside we will work towards inside. So in this case, point X, point Y and point Z can be accurately fixed on the alignment AB only. Suppose we are not working on this hole to part and we are working from part to hole, that means we are starting from one point and we are trying to reach on another point. In that case, what can happen? Suppose I started from this point. I know that I need to, my alignment is in this direction, but due to some error, I have started moving in this direction. what will happen? I know the position of x, that at some distance from A, at certain distance from A, the point x will lie. But due to some reasons, I started moving in this direction rather than in this direction, than in this direction. What will happen? At this particular distance x, I'll mark the point, that I'll call this point as S test. Similarly, again, I will start moving further. At particular distance, again, I'll mark and I'll call this as the Y dash. Similarly, I'll move further at particular certain distance, again, I'll put a mark and I'll call this as Z dash. Similarly, last point, I'll call this as a B. So that rather than ending at the point B, I will end up at the B dash, which is not, which is something else, rather than the initial, or rather than the actual. I was supposed to end up at this point, but I will end up at this point. Just because of, as adopt the method, part to whole. This is not the principle of serving at all. So only we are saying that in this case, if you start working on part to whole, your errors will accumulate. You won't get the chance to minimize your error or to correct your errors. These errors will get accumulated at all the points. You can see here, we have started working part to whole. Yeah, we have not considered the outer frame. We have considered only the initial point. We have started from one point to another point. So you can see here, the errors are starting getting accumulated, and we have end up with this much amount of error, which cannot be correct at all. But if I should have been started from B to A, that is after considering this outer point, these control points, because at the next situation I was wrong the position of the alignment, so that easily with the accuracy I can take the x y. So we always work by considering the principle of whole to part. The part to whole is not at all allowed in the survey. Then we have the second principle. Location by two reference points. This is the location by two reference points in this principle. What we do, we try to find out the location of third point. If we want to find out the location of any point, at least we require the two reference points, or to say the two control points. Then with the help of those control points, we can find out the location or the relative position of the third point by using the linear measurement or by angular measurement. Suppose, for example, we try to understand here. These are the two points. Let's take in this the point A and this is the point B. This is a point A and this is a point B. I know these control points, so these control points are already located. Let's join it so that. So this A and B are the two reference points, or we can take it as the control points. We know the position of these. Then if you want to find out the location of some other point, then this other point or this same other point can be located with the help of these two reference points by adopting the linear measurement or the angular measurement, or by considering the both. Means either by taking only linear measurement or only angular measurement, or with the combination of linear and angular. How? That we will see in the first one. Here in the first we are considering only the linear measurement. A and B is known. Let's take this as C point. I know the distance, so what I will do? I will make a cut from the A. Similarly, I will make another cut from the B. So the intersection of these two arc will give us the position of third point. So this is nothing but the linear measurement. This is the linear measurement. This is also the linear measurement. So with the help of linear measurement, we have find out the location of third point. Here reference points are A and B. Then second we can take up, A and B is known to us, this is A, this is B. Here we will take one linear measurement and one angular measurement. I will come at the midpoint, let's call this as a D. So from B to D or A to D, this will be the linear measurement, and then we'll take the angular measurement, that is at 90 degree. We have moved. We know that this distance, so we'll make a, again this linear measurement. We'll make a, we'll cut an arc, so we'll get the position of C. So this will be the position of C. We'll join the BC. Similarly, the AC. This is using one angular measurement and one linear measurement. Then next, third, this is also one angular measurement and one linear measurement. This is a point A, this is a point B. Here, first of all, we will make the angular measurement. I know this angle. So, I have made this. Similarly, now we will do, we will apply the linear measurement. We will make an arc. Somewhere it will come, it will cut to this direction. That will be the position of C. We will join this from A to C. So, we got the position of C. Again, angular measurement and linear measurement, then fourth one, again one angular measurement and one linear measurement, point A, point B. Similarly, I make one angular measurement from here. I know the position of C from A, so I make an arc from point A. It will cut the direction BC somewhere. That will be the position of C. Let's call it as C now. Join it. One angular measurement and one linear measurement. First one was both are linear measurement. This was the linear and angular. This is angular and linear. This is also angular and linear. Now the last we will see both are the angular measurement. I think it's very easy now. Everything can understand. This is portion A, this is portion B. If both are the angular measurement, we have to make one angular measurement from B and another angular measurement from A. The intersection of both will give us the position of C. This is the position of C. So these are some basic principles of surveying. This is the location of point or location of any station point by to reference point. Here we can find out the location of third point either by both the linear measurement or the angular measurement or with the combination of angular and linear measurement. Now we will move towards the chain survey. Here is some of the instrument that are, those are required for the chain survey. First of all, as we are doing the chain survey, so chain is a main equipment or main instrument which we require. So chain, then tap, arrows, ranging rod, or sometimes we use offset rod also, pads and plumb bombs. So what are these? That you will see in subsequent slides. So here are some of the chains what we are using nowadays. We use metric chain, then Gunter chain, surveyors. Gunter chain is also known as the surveyor chain, then the engineer's chain, revenue chain, and steel or bend chain. This metric chain, I'll call this as first. So this first one, which is the metric chain. This metric chain used to be either 20 meter or 30 meter generally. This is available in market. Both 20 meter chain is also available, as well as 30 meter chain is also available. The Gunter chain or the surveyor chain. Then we have the engineer chain, revenue chain. This Gunter chain is used to be of 33 feet height, or I mean the 33 feet length. And this revenue chain is used to be of 66 feet length, and this engineer chain is of 100 feet. So, there are some of the types of chain. We will study detail and detail about the mental change in the subsequent. There are some of the features of chain. Here this is known as the handle. This is the handle. This outer point of the chain is considered as the starting point, or here this is considered as the starting point or the end point. This is a brass handle or the simple handle of the chain. Once you untie it, it will look like that. That is the open view of the chain. You can see this is the schematic diagram of the chain. As you have seen, the metal chains are in the length of 20 meter and 30 meter both. Fine. This is the handle. As you have seen, this is the handle, and these are the tellies. So it has the links. If it is 20 meter chain, then it has 100 links. If it is 30 meter chain, then it has 150 links. And the length of one link is 20 centimeter. What is the length of one link? Here we can see there are three ovals. These are known as the ovals. So here also oval. So from this point, from the middle one, from this to this, this is nothing but one link. So length of this one link is 20 cm. Either it is 20 cm, either it is 20 meter like metric chain, or it is 30 meter metric chain. The length of one link remains always same, that is the 20 cm. So here are the ovals, and this is the link. It is made up of the galvanized steel. The dia of the material is 4 mm, that is, this is the chain, the diameter of this is 4 mm. Here, as we are using the word here, stylus, the stylus are nothing but, we provide the stylus at every 5 meter length. Stylus is also known as by the name of glass stylus. This will provide at every 5 meter. So this is at every 5 meter, this is 10 meter. Here you can see one groove, here this will be 3 grooves, means at 5 meter it will be something like this. Brass rings we provide at every 1 meter. So that the measurement will be easy, so that we can read the distance or we can measure the distance easily. If it is coming, first of all see the tags or the tallies, so that we can directly read 5 meter, 10 meter, 15 meter. Then further we look for the rings. If after we have reached somewhere, then we have find, suppose these are the rings, so we can wait, read it 15, and this is 16 meter, this is 17 meter. After that, there is two links, then it will be 17.4 meter, because the length of one link is 20 centimeter, that is nothing but 0.2 meter. So if there are two number of links, so the length of total links will be 0.4 meter. So total length of the so total length measure with the chain will be 17.4 meter. This is about chain. This we use for the measurement of distance.